blood only pointed ahead to the fact that one day, a perfect priest would come, and that priest would finally offer a sacrifice that was worthy to pay for our sins, that would actually cover our, not only cover our sins, but pay for our sins. All the other offerings were just a picture of Christ. But then Christ comes. He comes and he offers the perfect sacrifice. Hebrews 4:14 says that Christ passed through the heavens, plural. Paul tells us 2 Corinthians 12, 2-4, that he was caught up to the third heaven. The Jews had an idea that there were really three heavens. You think about it, it was quite logical. The first heaven is the atmosphere where the birds fly. The second heaven would be what we would call space, where the stars and the moons are. But then there is a third heaven, the dwelling place of God. The scripture says that Christ actually passed through the heavens into the very dwelling place of the Father, and there he offered his sacrifice, the sacrifice of his own blood. And since both the sacrifice and the high priest were perfect, his work was finished. So unlike the earthly high priest, the scripture says he sat down at the right hand of the Father, Hebrews 9:12. Not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood he entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. The earthly priest entered into the Holy of Holies in the temple once a year that symbolized the throne room of God. Christ actually ascended into the real throne room of heaven and offered his sacrifice before the Father. He made the perfect atonement of our sins by presenting his own blood once for all. Once for all. It is no accident that shortly after Christ's death on the cross, the Romans came and destroyed the temple, and the Jewish priesthood disappeared. And then when the Christian church comes along, the church does not establish a priesthood, not initially anyway, because they understood we didn't need a human priest. We have direct access to God through Christ, who is our mediator. He has become our great high priest. He has become the one who is the mediator between God and men. We don't need another priest. We don't need another way to access God. The idea that we need a priest is not taught anywhere in the New Testament. We are all priests in the sense that we can equally approach God on our own through Christ. And folks, any attempt to establish a priesthood that can offer forgiveness for sin or make atonement for sin by repeating Christ's sacrifice through some ritual, some sacrament, folks, that is unbiblical, it is unscriptural, it is ungodly, it is blasphemous. It is open defiance of the finished work of Christ. When Christ died, the veil of the temple was rent from top to bottom, giving us direct access to God. So we don't have to go through a priest anymore. Christ is our priest. That is God's Christmas gift to you. You have the perfect priest. That's God's Christmas gift, the perfect high priest. His gift to you that offers the perfect sacrifice. Second, he's the perfect priest because he sympathizes with us. Verse 15, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. You see, our God, as Christians, our God is unlike any other God. Every other religion you encounter, their God is completely different because our God came down to earth and became a man and walked amongst us. That's what separates us from the God of the pagan and the God of the Muslim and every other God. Our God came to share in our temptations and our sufferings so that he could be our sympathetic and understanding high priest. It's an old song that says, "No one understands like Jesus," and it's true. At the tomb of Lazarus, Jesus wept with grief. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he sweats drops of blood. He suffered in every way what we suffered. He hungered. He thirsted. He was betrayed. He was beaten. He was abused. He suffered everything that we suffer, including temptation. And yet was without sin. In fact, folks, did you know that Jesus suffered more temptation than you will ever endure in your entire life? You say, oh, Jesus doesn't know the kind of temptation I go through. Yes, he does. He suffered greater temptation than any other human being and never gave in. Never gave in. You know, I know that. Because, folks, let me just explain this to you. There's a certain threshold of pain that a human body can endure. And when you get to that point, once you pass that threshold, the body just shuts down. You pass out to relieve the pain. There's a similar mechanism with temptation. Once temptation reaches a certain level, folks, you and I will give in. Temptation reaches a certain level, we just give in, and then the temptation is relieved. Christ endured the full blast of temptation and never gave in. It got stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger, and yet he never gave in. He endured greater levels of temptation than we can imagine, and yet did not give in to it. He has suffered in every way that we have. The Jews couldn't imagine a God like that. The God of the Old Testament to them was a distant God. He could only be approached through a mediator, through the high priest, and only on the Day of Atonement. It was even harder for the Gentiles. The Stoic philosophers believed that God's primary attribute was that he was apathetic. He didn't have any feelings at all. The Greeks and Romans believed that God was completely cut off from the suffering of mankind. Their gods were petty and capricious and selfish and completely unconcerned with our benefit or our welfare. The idea of a God that could sympathize with us, that recognized our weaknesses, that resonated with our weaknesses at all points, was tempted as we were, that was foreign to the Jews. It was foreign to the Greeks. As Christians, folks, we have a God that is unlike any other. Our great high priest has not only been there, done that, but has the scars to prove it. Scars that will be visible even in heaven itself. Fanny Crosby, the great hymn writer, wrote over 8,000 hymns. What was interesting about her, she was completely blind. One day she was sitting in a room, and a skeptic had come to see her, and he was talking to her, and he told her, he said, how can you say that you will know Jesus when you see him? You're blind, you can't even see. How will you recognize him when you get to heaven? He walked out. Fanny Crosby thought about that. She sat down and she began to pen the words to an old hymn. I shall know him, I shall know him, and redeemed by his side I shall stand. I shall know him, I shall know him, by the prints of the nails in his hand. Still visible in heaven, the nails in his hand. We have a God who sympathizes with us. Well, Pastor, is that important? Is it important that he sympathizes with us? It's important to me. It is to me. There was a Salvation Army preacher by the name of Tucker Booth many years ago, and he was preaching a sermon. He was talking about how God was sufficient for all things. He could carry us through any grief or hurt or trial. There was a man who came to him after the service and told him, said, you say that. So, but this week I lost my wife. And the grief has been crushing. And he said, if you had lost your wife, you wouldn't be able to stand up there and say that God will help you through all things. Well, by an ironic turn of events, that very week, Tucker Booth's wife was killed in an accident. And he preached her funeral. And he stood in the pulpit and he said, if that man who talked to me and said that God is not sufficient, if he's here today, I want to tell him that I've experienced what you've experienced. And I know he is. At the end of the service, that man was there. He came and he found him. And together they knelt and they prayed, and that man received Christ. It makes a difference when someone has felt your pain, who's endured what you have endured. Christ has endured the same pain we have. He is our sympathetic high priest. He is our perfect priest. He has suffered as we have, and yet the Scripture says, without sin. That's important too. He has never sinned. We say, well, Pastor, how can he know what I'm going through if he's never experienced sin? You don't have to experience sin to know all about it, do you? Yeah, a cancer doctor, you talk to a cancer doctor who has battled cancer his whole life, he knows more about cancer than his patients who have it because he's fought it his whole life. Jesus is like that. He knows more about sin than we ever will. And yet he has never sinned himself. He's perfect and can be our perfect sacrifice. Someone who understands your battle, someone who has been through your hurts, that is God's Christmas gift to you. A high priest who is sympathetic to you. Who's sympathetic to you. Folks, I can't tell you, when I've sinned, when I've failed, when I go to the Lord in prayer, it is comforting me to know that Jesus is sympathetic. He's sympathetic. That's God's gift to you. Finally, we have a perfect priest who, because he is the only one who can save us. Verse 16, Hebrews 4:16. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Twice this verse talks about his grace and once about his mercy. Grace and mercy. The one who understands us perfectly also has provided for us perfectly. Provided for our payment for sin. 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has overtaken you except such as common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you're able, but with the temptation will also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. The one who knows our temptations will also lead us out of them. And when we fall to them, he will forgive us for them. He has given us salvation and forgiveness through his death on the cross. Now, how do we escape temptation? Well, the first way is to draw near the throne of grace. Unfortunately, we can do that with Christ. We can draw near Christ. You know, in ancient times, most rulers were completely unapproachable. Most ancient kings, you could not get anywhere near them. In fact, if you know the story of Esther, the Queen Esther, she risked her very life to approach King Ahasuerus without his invitation, even though she was his own wife. It could have cost her life to enter into her presence. Folks, any one of us can enter into the presence of Almighty God because Christ has made a way, confident of his grace and his mercy. Christ has transformed the throne of God's judgment into the throne of grace by shedding his blood in the perfect sacrifice for us. What a high priest we have. Our sacrifice, who sympathizes with us and saves us, what more could he do? And what's more, he is the only way to salvation. No other name given amongst men by which you must be saved but Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father except by me. Jesus is the only way to salvation. Now that doesn't resonate in our society. It's very pluralistic that likes to believe, well, we all worship the same God. We just call him by different names. No, that's not true. Jesus is the only name given amongst men by which you must be saved. Jesus is the only way to salvation. There is no other way to salvation. I believe that. I preach that. I've lived my life based on that. Folks, if I had one hair on my head that believed that there was another way to be saved, I'd pluck that thing out. Jesus is the only way to salvation. He's provided for us through his shed blood on the cross. He's become our perfect high priest. Salvation, heaven, and eternal life is found in Jesus and Jesus alone. And that's God's gift to you. What marvelous gifts God has given us at Christmas. What marvelous gifts. He's given us this wonderful high priest who is our only way to salvation, who sympathizes with us, who hears our prayers, who is gracious and merciful toward us. Let me ask you a question this morning. Have you accepted God's gift to you of a perfect high priest? Have you received that Christmas gift this morning? Because the Bible says it's not enough for God just to offer it and provide it. You've got to receive it. You've got to receive the gift. God offers it, and today you can receive it. I can't think of a better time to receive God's gift of a high priest, salvation and eternal life, than at Christmas time. In just a moment, we're going to sing a hymn of invitation. I'm going to be down here at the front. If you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have not received that gift of a perfect high priest and salvation and eternal life in Jesus, I'm going to invite you to come to the front and say, Pastor, I want to know about this Jesus you've been talking about, and I'll share with you how you can know Christ as your Savior this very morning. As our musicians come, let me encourage you. Let me encourage you, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, to make that commitment today, to make the move of putting your faith in Him and Him alone as your Savior. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Will you pray with me as we pray for our neighbors around us? Lord, we pray for those who are here this morning. For the believers in Christ, we ask, Lord, that we would have the courage to proclaim the truth of the perfect high priest that you've given us and the salvation that we have in Jesus. But for that one who may be here this morning who has not received Christ as their Savior, we just pray, Lord, that they would see their need for a Savior. Lord, we know that the Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you that you've said that if we will confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we will be saved. We ask, Lord, that you would move upon the hearts of everyone here this morning. If there's any that doesn't know Christ, that you would draw them to salvation, that today may be their day of salvation. We know that you're glorified in no greater way than when one believer comes to Christ. And we ask, Lord, that you would be glorified today. Thank you, Lord, for this season, this time in which we celebrate the birth of Christ. We thank you, Lord, for the fact that there are so many around us who are more sensitive to the gospel during this time. Help us to be bold, to tell the truth about Christmas, and to recognize that Jesus is the reason for the season. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Let's stand.